Well, good afternoon, everyone. My name is Peter Robinson. I'm the CEO of the David Suzuki Foundation, and I'd like to welcome you to what is sure to be a very interesting discussion about the future of Canada's oil sands. The David Suzuki Foundation is pleased to be co-sponsoring this event with Carbon Talks and the Centre for International Governance Innovation, CG. And I just want to point out Alicia Clancy here from CG. If you get a chance, if you want to find out some more about CG, she'll be around afterwards to learn a little bit more. And by the way, this is the first time that the David Suzuki Foundation and CG have co-sponsored something. So I'm absolutely delighted that we've had this opportunity to get to know each other. There'll be two more of these events with Jeff, one in Toronto, one in Montreal. So we'll get to know each other a little bit better along the way. The event tonight is going to highlight CG Senior Fellow Jeff Rubin's work with the Global Economy Program. And I'd like to begin tonight's event with a tradition that is part of the culture at the David Suzuki Foundation now, and that is to acknowledge that this event is taking place on the unceded traditional territories of the Musqueam, Tsleil-Waututh, and Squamish Nations. And I'm very honored to invite one of the Musqueam representatives, Nola Charles, to welcome us. So come on up, Nola.
Thank you, Peter. I'm in taking place of my mother, who was actually going to do the welcoming tonight, but it's called life. Had a bit of an incident at home. We got a little guy, had a bit of an accident, but he's going to be okay. But at the end of the day, you know how mothers are. They're worrying. That's why... you're stuck with me. So for those of you who don't know where Musqueam is, it's out by UBC. It's right across the river from the airport. Thank you, Peter. And I guess I've got the best of both worlds because my father is from Musqueam, my late father's from Musqueam, and my mother's from Tsleil-Waututh. So I'm in my mother's place. I don't have a prepared prayer like she does. I'll just offer some thanks for what I'm thankful for today. And just reflecting back, sitting at the back, I'm thankful for, I've got clean drinking water. That's not the case in all of BC, the communities that I visited, the 203 First Nations that I've actively participate for, with. I'm thankful for the Suzuki Foundation for the engagement strategy. I'm thankful for these people here that are actually, we don't know each other's positions until we actually talk about it. So you've got to start the talk somewhere. And so I'm thankful for that. And the only thing that Peter asked me to keep it short and sweet, I could go on all night. But in your own way, at some point tonight, before you lay your head down to rest, give yourself a little thanks for what you're thankful for, what's important to you in this world, in issues like this. Because at the end of the day, we're all in this together. And I'm thankful for the great neighbors that I've got, like the foundation, and I'll leave it at that. So I hope I did my mother some justice. I sing back home. One of the verses with Itsep, Itsep Mistimuch, which means I give great thanks for the people that are in my world. And we're all in this together, so you're all part of my world. So I give thanks for that. And I'll stay on Peter's case to make sure that I get involved, because I have to get involved to make a change. And I'll be sitting on the side and listening with interest. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Nola. Now, the timing of today's discussion couldn't be better, with hundreds of countries now having committed to these aggressive GHG emission reduction targets at the UN climate talks in Paris this past December. And this international agreement has sent a clear signal to world markets and future investors that we are now living in a carbon-constrained world. But what does that mean for global oil production and consumption and the future of Canada's oil sands? So we're very fortunate to have Jeff Rubin here tonight to give us his thoughts on this. Jeff is a world-leading energy expert and former chief economist at CIBC World Markets. He is currently a senior fellow at CG, researching the impacts and opportunities in Canada for the transition towards a more sustainable economic model. And he's also an international best-selling author known for his books, Why Your World is About to Get a Whole Lot Smaller, The End of Growth, and The Carbon Bubble. The Carbon Bubble was just nominated for the National Business Book Award. That's one of Canada's most prestigious literary awards. And Why Your World is About to Get a Lot Smaller, a Whole Lot Smaller, won this award in 2010. Just yesterday, CG released a new copy of a report by Jeff titled The Future of Canada's Oil Sands in a Decarbonizing Global Economy. I think there's still some copies out on the table there. I don't think we brought one for everyone, though, did we, Alicia? Okay. It is available online, though? Okay. And I look forward to hearing Jeff's discussion on the report's findings. After we hear from Jeff, we are delighted to have two distinguished panelists join the discussion. The first is Dermot Foley. From Vancity. Dermot has over 25 years of experience in social and environmental experience in social environmental advocacy, research, and policy. He has worked in the investment division at Vancity since 2003. Dermot is responsible for analyzing companies' environmental performance, commitments to social responsibility, and corporate governance. He is also responsible for determining investment strategies for shareholder engagement. Prior to joining Vancity in 2003, he spent 6 years as a senior policy analyst at the David Suzuki Foundation for our climate change program. So also joining the panel discussion is Karen Mahan from Forest Ethics, although I'm told that that might change soon. I won't give it away. Is it public knowledge? All right. Karen is a strategist, organizer, negotiator, and speaker with more than 25 years' experience focusing on issues related to environment and the economy. Early in her career, she led the campaign to protect the old growth rainforest of the Clackwood Sound, now a UN biosphere reserve, and she was a principal architect of the multi-sector collaboration that led to the protection of the Great Bear Rainforest. Karen has worked as a strategic consultant for a wide variety of private, public, and nonprofit organizations in her mission to strengthen the impact of civil society organizations. And as I said, she currently leads Forest Ethics in Canada, although that's going to change. And this is where she is focused on limiting the expansion of fossil fuel infrastructure projects while amplifying the opportunities for clean energy solutions. The moderator for tonight's panel will be Michael Small, who is a fellow of SFU's Center for Dialogue and the executive director of Climate Talks, which is co-sponsoring this event tonight with the David Suzuki Foundation and CG. And following the panel discussion, there will be an opportunity for questions from you to the panelists and to Jeff. And after the Q&A session, there will be a catered reception at the back of the room from 6:30 to 7:30. I hope you will all stay, enjoy more conversation, and we can continue that discussion at that time. Now, I'm going to invite Michael to come forward and say a few words about Carbon Talks, but before I do so, I should let Jeff know that I asked David Suzuki if he wanted me to say a word about him. Now, David is in Australia at the moment. He's doing some speaking tours down there, but he wrote back immediately to say, and Jeff, I quote directly, "All of my stories about Jeff are too risque to recount." So, Michael, over to you. Thank you, folks.
They wouldn't be too risque to recount in Australia, however, so I'm sure he's, I hope he's doing that. Sorry, this is being, let me just see if my lapel mic is working. It is. Great, it's a great pleasure. I'm Michael Small, as previously announced. It's a great pleasure on behalf of Simon Fraser University and specifically the Center for Dialogue and hosting you all here in our downtown Vancouver campus. Carbon Talks is a program of the Center for Dialogue. We do public events like this about once a month here on a variety, on a wide variety of issues dealing with climate change from lots of different facets. But it's a real delight to have do an event tonight. We call this a special Carbon Talks because it's on a bigger issue with two important partners, three distinguished speakers. All of our Carbon Talks events are recorded, and tonight that's also true. So this will be viewable online on our Carbon Talks YouTube website after the fact if you want to look at it or encourage other people to view it. We always like to thank our sponsors that make it possible for us to conduct these events and do the recording, the North Growth Foundation, which supports Carbon Talks as a whole, and the Pacific Institute for Climate Solutions, which specifically enables us to do the video recording. If you'd like to tweet, the hashtag that we suggest you use is @oilsands.
please do so. Otherwise, do turn off at least the ringer part of your phone, as in any public event. And with that, I'd like to go turn over to Jeff and ask Jeff Rubin to give the presentation on his paper on the issue of the future of the oil sands in a carbon-constrained world. Jeff.
Newly elected Prime Minister Trudeau and Premier Notley in Alberta have worked earnestly to rehabilitate Canada's badly tarnished environmental image in the lead up to COP21. For much of the last decade, the Canadian government's singular focus on the oil sands as an engine of economic growth and the resultant lack of progress on reducing national carbon emissions has frequently isolated Canada as a pariah at such international gatherings. While new governments in Ottawa and Alberta wasted little time in moving the environmental goalposts, at COP21, Prime Minister Trudeau endorsed the more stringent target, limiting climate change to 1.5 degrees. He also said that the previous commitment by the Harper government to reduce national emissions to 30% below 2005 levels by 2030 was a bare minimum for his government. Premier Notley has even moved more aggressively. For the first time in history, the Alberta government has imposed a hard cap 100 megaton limit on annual emissions from the oil sands. She's introduced a province-wide carbon tax at $17 a ton next year, moving to, at $20 a ton next year, moving to $30, and has also signaled the phase out of coal-fired power, which presently accounts for roughly half of the province's power generation. Taken at face value, stances from both Alberta and Ottawa appear to be an abrupt reversal from the oil sand Harper government-dominated agenda and that government's open skepticism of climate change. Certainly in broad direction they are, but yet both Trudeau and Notley have argued, at least in part when pitching it to the oil sands, that rehabilitating Canada's badly tarnished environmental image will actually safeguard the future development of the oil sands resource. It, of course, wouldn't be the first time that a country has adopted green policy initiatives in defense of its oil industry. For example, Saudi Arabia is right now spending billions of dollars on solar energy to prevent soaring domestic oil demand from cannibalizing its oil exports. Saudi Arabia burns about 1 million barrels a day just to power its desalination plants. Well, in a similar vein, Canada's newfound commitment to improve its environmental image on the carbon front is at least being pitched to the oil sand industry as an attempt to improve the oil sands marketability in what is going to become an increasingly emission-conscious global energy markets. In fact, both Trudeau and Notley have gone so far as to say that the country's notoriously poor record on carbon emissions under the Harper government has actually hurt the oil sands expansion plans that the former prime minister had so famously championed. Premier Notley, for example, has cited President Obama's rejection of the Keystone XL pipeline as evidence of this phenomenon. While this political narrative is gaining increasing traction across the post-Harper Canada, the notion that Canada's oil sands industry is somehow tied to its environmental performance or the country's environmental performance offers, in my view, little recognition of the problems facing the oil sands today, and even less recognition of the problems the oil sands will face if indeed other countries live up to their commitments made at COP21 and restrict carbon emissions. You see, at the end of the day, it's not Alberta's emissions, nor for that matter, the oil sands emissions, that really threatens the sector's viability. The oil sands is not being developed so Canadians can fuel up. The fact of the matter is that Canada already produces double the oil that it consumes. And like most OECD countries, oil consumption has been declining. The real liability or danger to the oil sands is the impact of the international community, not on the 1.6% of emissions that come from Canada, but the 98.4% emissions that come outside of Canada. By destroying billions of barrels of future world oil demand, policies around the world to limit carbon emissions deal a lethal blow to high-cost sources of fossil fuel supply, whether that be oil sands, whether that be shale, whether that be deep water, or whether that be Arctic. You see, in the final analysis, it's not the 17% higher emissions on a well-bore-to-wheels basis that the oil sands bitumen produces more than conventional oil that is their problem. The oil sands' major problem in a decarbonizing world economy is that they are one of the highest cost sources of oil supply found anywhere in the world. I mean, second only to Arctic. And as a high cost source of oil, they are extremely dependent on very strong world oil demand and on very high oil prices. They are what we call in economics the marginal producer. Now, there are benefits to being the marginal producer. In a world of rising prices, the marginal producer has the most to gain. 20, 25 years ago, the oil sands were ignored by the industry because they weren't viewed as being a commercially viable source of supply. The cost of extraction and upgrading the fuel couldn't be justified under existing oil prices. However, when prices started to soar, very few sectors are in the world industry benefited more than the oil sands. In fact, as recently as a year and a half ago, there was more planned investment in the Alberta oil sands than in any other oil-producing region in the world. Of course, the problem with being the marginal supplier is that while you benefit the most from rising prices, you are the most vulnerable to falling prices. And that, of course, is where the oil sands exist today. And let us remember that we are still in a very strong world oil market. Oil demand grew last year by about 1.8 million barrels a day. That's the largest increase in the last 5 years. Realize the predicament the industry has in a still an expanding market, and then consider its future in what must ultimately be a contracting market. Well, you know, I said at the beginning that Premier Notley in Alberta referenced President Obama's rejection of the Keystone XL pipeline as evidence that the sector's very poor environmental image is hurting it. Well, that may be true or maybe not true, but the fact is that the dirty oil that President Obama has referred to it has nevertheless been one of the most important sources of U.S. supply. The oil sands problem isn't that it's been targeted by sanctions or by environmental groups. The oil sands problem is that oil imports in the United States have been halved over the last 5 years. The oil sands has the largest market share in the United States. It's 45% of all oil imports. Again, the problem being that the level of imports has been cut in half. Why? Well, because of another high cost source of supply, not quite as high cost as the oil sands, also an environmentally problematic source of supply, and that is the shale revolution. Now, the shale revolution has had a devastating impact on a number of energy industries. Natural gas production in the U.S. doubled, natural gas prices plummeted to the point where it has basically bankrupted the coal industry because it is now cheaper to generate power by burning natural gas than it is burning coal. President Obama no longer requires. And certainly coal would be a perfect example. President Obama has basically, through the EPA, made it virtually impossible to build new coal-fired generating plants in the United States, but he only did that after shale gas had basically made coal economically expensive. Well, just as the shale revolution unlocked huge reserves of gas that have closed coal plants, and coal's share of U.S. power generation has gone from over 40% to now around 25% and dropping every year, the shale revolution also led to huge increases in oil supply. 5 million barrels of oil produced in places that no one had ever heard of before, like the Bakken in North Dakota, Eagle Ford, and the Permian Basin in Texas, suddenly made Canadian oil sand redundant in the U.S. market. That, of course, had some pretty dramatic implications here in Canada. All of a sudden, what was thought to be the natural and infinite market for increased oil sand production, you know, the largest oil-consuming country in the world, just as our neighboring country, all of a sudden, that was no longer going to be the market. It led for the desperate search for tidewater and overseas markets for two reasons. One, because access to global markets became critical to justify increased production, and secondly, much better pricing. The oil sands isn't just one of the most expensive oil in the world to produce, it also gets the cheapest price. When you turn on the radio or television or look at the Globe and Mail or whatever and see oil prices and $37, $38, that's not the price that oil sand producers get. Oil sand producers get something called Western Canadian Select. It trades at anywhere from a 25 to 60% discount to world oil prices. Today, Western Canadian Select is trading at around $15 a barrel. Brent, the Tidewater price, is about $37, $38. And hence, all of a sudden, it wasn't Keystone XL, but the need to get domestic pipelines to both the Atlantic and Pacific coast. In this province, of course, Northern Gateway, that would have taken bitumen to Kitimat and then shipped to Asian markets. A twinning of the Trans Mountain pipeline that whose terminus is not far from here in Burnaby, British Columbia. And of course, the Energy East proposal from TransCanada that would ship oil all across the country to St. John's, New Brunswick, where it would then be sold in the Atlantic Basin. Well, I mean, those are the sort of narratives that are being talked about. The industry saying that we need to get to world oil prices and desperately need for pipelines. Of course, pipelines are only valid if they are delivering fuel that is economically viable. Before talking about the viability of the oil sands product in a decarbonizing global economy around the corner, let's talk about the viability of oil sands in today's market. There is no economic context for any of the pipelines being proposed. 2 years ago, there was an economic context. 2 years ago, Brent, the global price for oil, was trading at over $100 a barrel. Today, Brent is trading at $37. A couple of weeks ago, was trading as low at $30 a barrel. At those prices, not only does the planned expansion of the oil sands from 2.5 to 4 or 5 million barrels a day have no economic context, could not be funded by any financial institution in Canada. In fact, what you've been hearing from the CEOs of the major chartered banks is emphasizing to their shareholders their limited exposure to the sector. Not only does it have no context, but it totally changes the conversation. Because even at getting world oil prices are now well below the cost of current production. So the question becomes, how long can this sector produce 2.3, 2.5 million barrels a day when it's losing anywhere from $15 to $25 a barrel? If you look at the share valuations of oil sand producers, they're only marginally better than Peabody Energy, Alpha Resources, Arch Coal, all the major coal producers in the US that have already lost between 90 to 95% of their share value. Canadian Natural Resources, Canadian Oil Sands, down about 60 to 80%, even Imperial Oil, Suncor, down 30 to 40%. Some of the major producers now have been downgraded to junk bond status, like, for example, Encana and Cenovus. So where does this leave us? It leaves us with limited access to capital markets. It leaves an industry that's producing at a huge loss. Now, of course, if you're the oil sand producers, you are waiting for other people to cut production. The reason that oil prices have fallen from over $100 a barrel to $37 a barrel is because today we face the largest glut in world oil markets since the mid-80s. In fact, the International Energy Agency estimates that it's about 3 billion barrels, that every day a production is at least a million barrels greater than world demand. Now, if you listen to the oil sand producers or the shale producers, they're waiting for Saudi Arabia, they're waiting for OPEC to shut in production. But the huge increase in global supply has not come from Saudi Arabia, OPEC. OPEC is producing roughly the same 31, 32 million barrels a day that they have been for the last couple of years. There's been some changes in the composition of OPEC. Iran's production because of sanctions has gone down. Iraq's production has gone up with foreign investment in its oil industry. But on the whole, over 80% of the increase in world supply over the last 5 years that has now led to this big glut in the oil market comes from outside of OPEC. And the biggest source of that glut comes from right here. When I say right here, I say North America. You see, in the pursuit of energy independence, which has been the watchword of energy policy in North America since the OPEC oil shocks, what we have done is we have traded our dependence on low-cost imported oil from OPEC to a newfound dependence on high-cost domestic supply. Because the increases in shale production, about 5 million barrels a day, the increase in oil sands production, over a million barrels a day, rank among some of the highest cost sources of oil in the world, and therefore, their commercial viability is dependent on very high prices. Now, you will hear, of course, a refrain from the sector, and indeed, the International Energy Agency is already warning that shutting in high-cost production will make us more and more vulnerable to OPEC cuts. But the point being that if we're going to see cutbacks, if we're going to see this glut removed, if we're going to see a recovery to high prices, it's the very sectors that are now so desperate to see a price recovery that will have to shut in production. And that's beginning to happen in the United States. Now, in the last 7 months, shale production has already declined by about 600,000 barrels a day, and the U.S. Energy Information Administration Department is projecting another 500,000 barrel a day cut in production. Yet higher costs, significantly higher cost, oil sand production has not been shut in. Why? It's the nature of the resource. Shale wells are much more scalable. They have very rapid depletion rates. Oil sand projects are mega projects. An oil sand mine can't just be shut down. And once you shut down an oil sand mine, the startup costs are so huge that you may never reopen it. That means that the shale industry has become much more responsive to oil prices than the oil sand industry. However, hanging over the oil sand industry like the sword of Damocles is the fact that they are hemorrhaging red ink, because in today's oil prices, the oil sands aren't a commercially viable source of supply. Now let's talk a little bit about the future of what was 195 countries committed to COP21 to decarbonize the global economy. What does that specifically mean? Well, if we're going to limit global temperature increases to 2 degrees, and now there's an effort to reduce that, to limit that to only 1.5, we have to stabilize atmospheric carbon at about 450 parts per million. The Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change estimated that we have a remaining global carbon budget of around 1,000 gigatons. That sounds like a huge number until you scale it to actual annual emissions for the global economy that are running around 32, 34 gigatons. That means we basically have 30 years of combusting fossil fuels. Sure, we could extend that maybe to 60 years if we cut our combustion in half. But the fact of the matter is that in the very near term, we're going to have to significantly reduce our use of fossil fuels. The International Energy Agency, which is, I guess, the world's most authoritative body on energy consumption, modeled what a 450 part per million world looks like in terms of oil consumption. Right now, world oil consumption is running around 95 million barrels a day. They would say that in order to stabilize carbon at 450, in order to stabilize global temperatures at no more than a 2% increase, that world oil consumption has to peak by 2020. And that over the next 20 years, we will have to lose some 20 million barrels a day of world production. Well, we're not going to lose 20 million barrels a day of world production in Saudi Arabia, where the cost of production is $10 a barrel, or in Iran and Kuwait, where it's $9 a barrel. It's not coming out of OPEC, because OPEC is the low-cost producer. It's coming specifically out of high-cost production. Well, these are the time frames, the very time frames, that the oil sands industry was planning to double production from 2.5 to 5 million barrels a day. Of course, underlying those production planned increases was the notion that we would have business as usual growth in world oil demand, that every year the global economy would need to consume another 1.5, 2 million barrels a day. It's a very different world if all of a sudden the global economy has to reduce consumption by 20 million barrels a day, particularly if you happen to be the high-cost marginal producer. The conversation is rapidly changing, and it's going to change even more from expansion to sustainability. Because in a decarbonizing global economy, not only is expansion out of the question, but the very sustainability of current production looks less and less viable. That what we're going to see in the future is a contracting oil sands industry. And that has some challenges, because our environmental and economic policies have all been tailor-made to accommodate a rapid expansion of what we thought was the engine of economic growth. On the economic side, if the oil sands are going to remain sustainable, the extraction model of basically increasing production and selling it at huge discounts to world oil prices to a handful of refineries in the United States does not make economic sense and will not be funded by capital markets. What is viable? Well, what may be viable is doing more with less. The oil sands isn't just one of the highest cost sources of production. It's one of the least processed oil in the world. In 2014, the last year that we have numbers for, something like over 50% of total oil sand production was not even upgraded into oil, let alone refined into diesel, gasoline, or petrochemicals. It was just exported as a bulk product to U.S. refineries. Well, the irony here is that at the kind of cost that the oil sands are, at Western Canadian Select trading at $15 a barrel, the oil sands bitumen is one of the cheapest feedstocks in the world and provides one of the most attractive refinery margins anywhere in the world. A refinery margin is the difference between what a refinery pays for its feedstock, oil and bitumen, and what it sells its refined products like gasoline and diesel. The irony being that the lack of refinery capacity, which is the reason why the oil sands product sells at such a huge discount, is in fact setting the conditions, ideal conditions, for refineries to actually be built in Alberta. So, looking forward, instead of 2.5 to 4 million barrels a day, I think a much more likely scenario is that in the future, oil sand production is probably going to be halved. And the real challenge will be to do more with the resource than simply the brute staple model of extraction. On the environmental side, the good news is that as the increase in oil sand production is no longer sustainable, neither is the emission trails that come with it. And indeed, one of the problems of Canada hitting its emission targets, whether it was the 2020 target or the 2030 target, was that the increase in emissions from the oil sands basically offset everything else that was done in the Canadian economy to decarbonize, like, for example, Ontario's decision to close all its coal plants. Well, we're not going to see that carbon trail in the sky because we're not going to see production increases. The environmental challenge isn't going to be the carbon trail in the atmosphere. It's going to be the footprint on the ground. Because has anybody thought about the costs of decommissioning an oil sands mine? Those millions of meters of tailing ponds just don't reclaim themselves. Now, the fund in Alberta that's supposed to deal with this is hopelessly underfunded, because no one thought that decommissioning was something that was going to occur in the here and now. Decommissioning was going to occur 40, 50 years from now, which is the typical economic lifetime of an oil sands mine. Ultimately, and that not perhaps ultimately, soon, we're going to see, because of financial stresses in the sector, oil sand mines closed. And it remains to be seen who will pick up the liability on that, because the conditions in which oil sand mines are closed are the conditions in which their operators are financially distressed, and hardly the situation where they can pony up billions of dollars for reclamation costs. So the economic challenge here is going to be to try to squeeze more value added out of significantly lower production in the future. The environmental challenge is going to be who's going to pay to clean up the mess that's left behind. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Jeff.
I think I'm on. Okay, thanks for providing me with an opportunity to speak at this event. Today I'm going to briefly talk about our approach to managing socially responsible mutual funds while dealing with climate risk. It's a bit of the real world experience. I've worked in the investment division at VanCity since 2003. I'm a member of a portfolio management team. that's responsible for selecting companies for the IA Clarington Enhanced SRI funds. And we manage roughly $500 million for our members. Now, in addition to traditional financial analysis, we also analyze company behavior in seven key areas. We look at their corporate governance standards, their employee relations, their environmental policies and practices, their record on community relations, human rights and diversity, and of course, their involvement in sustainable products. In total, we believe that companies are much more likely to be environmentally, socially, and financially sustainable when they balance the interests of all their stakeholders, the shareholders, the employees, the customers, and the community. And as Jeff mentioned, and as many of you know, risks related to climate change are becoming a major focus for many investors. So a little over a year ago, early 2015, we devised and implemented a new strategy to address the financial risks associated with climate change. And the risks we were most concerned with at the time include regulatory risks, a risk from what are called stranded assets, overall changes in demand, and of course, something called substitution risk. Now, in terms of regulatory risk, as we've already heard, in December at the Paris Convention on Climate Change, 195 countries agreed to begin the transition to a low-carbon economy. Now, in 1994, 22 years ago, and there are probably some people in this room who were at the Rio Convention 20 years ago. I'm talking about you, Paul. That's how long some of us have been working on this. Well, 22 years ago, the UN Framework Convention on Climate Change came into effect, and it was 194 countries at that point. Somehow, one other country has come along since then. They came into force with the objective of preventing dangerous interference with the climate system. And so that was an international law, an international agreement. And it's taken us 22 years to decide that dangerous interference begins at between 1.5 and 2 degrees Celsius. So that's how long it's taken. We used to use a bit of gallows humor when I worked at the Suzuki Foundation thing. You know, we work on climate change. My old boss used to say, jobs for life, because that's how long it's going to take us to deal with climate change over our entire lifetime. And so we believe that staying within that 1.5 to 2 degree limit means that over the next 5 years in particular, we're going to see emission reduction targets, regulations, and carbon taxes becoming common throughout the global economy. At the same time, the financial regulatory system, which governs how companies behave, is starting to get more involved. Following the 2008 financial crisis, the G20 created what's called the Financial Stability Board. And its job is to address vulnerabilities that might affect financial systems as a whole. And they've begun to realize that climate change is just such a vulnerability. And so they've begun investigating the need for better corporate disclosure on climate risk. At the same time, the New York Attorney General's office, which has jurisdiction over the largest and the busiest stock exchanges in the world, they've begun suing companies over the quality of information they're disclosing about climate risk. Because as investors, all you have is information. That's what you have to go on. And so companies have to disclose to investors what risks are. And some companies, like I believe it was Peabody Coal, said that there is no risk from climate change to us. And meanwhile, their shares have gone from $100 to $10, and they're verging on bankruptcy. But that, of course, isn't really about climate change, as far as they say, right? But now they have to disclose a bit more. We're also seeing changing levels of demand, which is adding further risk. As we mentioned, carbon pricing is starting to become a reality across Canada. Ontario has 37% of Canada's GDP. When you combine Ontario with BC, Alberta, and Quebec, we're going to see 85% of Canada's GDP under some form of carbon pricing mechanism. And the federal government has stated they're going to somehow make sure that the remaining 15% also comes under some sort of mechanism. Now, those prices may not be enough to influence a decision at an oil sands or tar sands, whatever you want to call them, plant, but they are decisions that affect homeowners and their decision around. And here in BC, we don't think about home heating oil, but I'm from Newfoundland, and people in Newfoundland use home heating oil all winter to keep their houses warm. And so the decisions around energy efficiency, around what type of heating system you're going to put in play, that is affected by carbon pricing. Similarly, around decisions around the type of automobile you might buy and other energy efficiency decisions. So we think that's going to impact demand. Stranded asset risk, which we talked about a little bit, it's also vitally important to long-term investors. Staying within that 1.5 to 2 degrees increase means that over two-thirds of the fossil fuel that's currently on the books won't be exploited. It won't be monetized. If you go to 1.5 degrees, it's more like one-fifth, so 80% will have to stay in the ground. The International Energy Agency actually made the statement that unless carbon capture and storage technology is widely deployed, no more than one-third of proven reserves of fossil fuel can be consumed prior to 2050. This may be one of the reasons that Saudi Arabia continues to flood the market, because oil that stays in the ground is not worth any money. So it's really in their interest to dominate the market and sell as much as they can, monetize it, and then use the money for something else. Now, even if carbon capture and storage technology is implemented, it's estimated to cost between $50 and $100 per ton of CO2. And that's a future, that's a projection of what it's going to cost. And so if you use that price as a proxy for the marginal cost of controlling a ton of emissions, it's something in pollution prevention, look at what's the cost at the end of the pipe. And so if that's the cost at the end of the pipe, it means that a barrel of oil contains enough emissions to basically, the emissions will be valued at between $32 and $65 per barrel. So the emissions cost is higher than the current cost of a barrel of oil if you use carbon capture and storage technology. And of course, at that price, a lot of other options start to look much more economical. And those options are likely to expand as a result of the Paris Agreement. And that's because the agreement commits countries to provide financing to allow developing countries to meet their energy needs while avoiding fossil fuel. They agreed to provide a minimum of $100 billion per year by 2020 to help developing countries bypass the development of fossil fuel, which of course leads to a much bigger and more competitive alternative energy industry. And so the substitution risk becomes much higher. So it seems pretty clear that climate change is going to impact the ability of many companies to deliver sustainable earnings, particularly fossil fuel producers. And so as fund managers, we address the risks and opportunities associated with climate change through a four-part strategy. It's based on divestment, decarbonization, reinvestment, and engagement. First of all, we divest by eliminating fossil fuel companies where there are viable alternative return opportunities. Now, that's a mouthful. But basically, what we're saying is because there are many alternative investment options outside Canada, we were able to fully divest fossil fuel companies from the IA Clarington Enhanced SRI Global Equity Fund, because the global market has a lot more opportunities. Where full divestment is not an option, then we decarbonize by reducing our exposure to companies that have above average emissions, energy use, or production costs. So for us, this meant we divested all oil sands companies from our IA Clarington Enhanced Monthly Income Fund and the IA Clarington Enhanced Canadian Equity Fund. And the main reason we did this was because of their high production costs combined with their emissions trajectory. Because if you look at the oil sands today, no one in the oil sands business seems to be interested in developing another business. They're mostly interested in buying another oil sands company or building another large mega project oil sands mine. And so from our perspective, the emissions trajectory was another reason that we wanted to reduce those risks. And what do we do with the proceeds? Well, we reinvested those proceeds into renewable and clean technology companies. For the Canadian funds, it's a little more difficult because there aren't that many options in renewable and clean technology. And so we looked at other factors and other sectors that have the potential to produce lower carbon energy and services. And so in total, we've invested in shares of companies that produce over 23,000 megawatts of renewable energy. That includes 13,000 megawatts of wind, 8,000 of hydro, and 2,500 of solar. If you use a 40% capacity factor for the wind and the hydro, and a measly 10% for the solar, that's enough power to meet the annual needs of 8 million households. So there is lots of opportunity out there in the world. There's just not a lot in Canada. And last but not least, we use our rights as shareholders to engage with other companies to encourage them to disclose what their climate risk exposure looks like. And that means filing resolutions with banks, insurance companies, transportation companies, and having them improve the amount of information they're providing to investors on what those risks might be. And we're not alone in this. Over the past year, or past couple of years, we've seen the growth of an increasingly sophisticated global movement encouraging divestment from fossil fuel. We've seen foundations, pension funds, endowments, they're all evaluating their exposure to climate risk and are developing policies to lower those risks. And within the investment industry itself, professional investment service firms, they're providing what's called fossil fuel-free indexes and benchmarks, and they're also advising managers on the processes to lower their exposure to fossil fuel producers. So in conclusion, we believe that climate risk is manifesting as a financial risk in today's market. It's not out there in the future somewhere. It's happening right now. So we think it's time for governments across Canada to develop and implement a transition plan for a low-carbon economy. This will help Canadians compete in the 21st century, and it'll also provide investors with more opportunities outside the fossil fuel industry. Because if you think of the tens of thousands of people that have been laid off in Alberta, who actually are from across the country in the last year and a half, well, that's a very good indication of what the future is going to look like for the oil sands industry. So instead of getting together with the provinces and talking about 5% reduction or 10% reduction, we really should be talking amongst intergovernmentally on how we're going to start that transition to a low carbon economy. So thanks a lot.
And now I'll invite Karen Mahone to give her remarks.
Thanks, Michael. Thanks, Jeff, and thanks, Dermot. That was very interesting. In my role as Executive Director of Forest Ethics here in Canada, soon to be named STAND, we're an environmental group that was born here in British Columbia and worked on forest issues from Clackwood Sands, the Great Bear Rainforest, to the Boreal, and now we are principally on climate and energy issues, so we are evolving our name, so look out, you'll hear us called STAND in the future. And in my role as Executive Director, I have, in the last couple of months, been lucky enough to have a front row seat on a lot of the policy making that you've heard about already here today, from the Alberta climate policy to Paris to the Kinder Morgan pipeline debate here in British Columbia. So I think what I can add, and before we open it up for questions and discussion here, is a little bit about some of the things I've seen sort of close up and personal, maybe behind the scenes that you haven't seen in the news, and add some dimension that way. So if you think back about a year and a half ago, before the Notley government was elected, in the Harper days, right, we were having basically a full-out civil war, a public debate, and there were only two sides. There was the we must do something side, and then there was the Harper and industry denial side. Groups like Forest Ethics were doing everything that we could to keep oil sands in the ground, things like campaigning in the US marketplace against Fortune 500 companies like Pepsi and Coke to get them to stop buying high carbon fuels like fuel from oil sands. So that was all going on, and we really had, you know, we really had very little dialogue and no governments were moving. We had everyone highly positional. At some point, there was a foray between some of the environmental groups and some of the oil sand companies to say, you know, are you ever going to move? Is this strategy of denial by the Harper government and oil sands companies really serving you at this time? There was very little appetite and not, as you can imagine, a lot of interest in dialogue between the oil companies and the environmental groups. But then the Notley government was elected in Alberta. And Rachel Notley made it very clear that they wanted to create a different path and start a different conversation. So they struck the leach panel, they did a big public process in Alberta, and at the same time, the Alberta government said to a number of environmental groups, including Forest Ethics, Sierra Club, others, Greenpeace, You environmental groups with all your big opinions, and you oil companies with all your big PR budgets, you go into that corner over there and you fight it out amongst yourselves, you two. Stop taking up all the public airspace. Of course, we're still working on our public issues. But you two go away and see if there's any pathways that you two can agree on. Because if there are any pathways that we can get the oil sands companies to agree on and the environmental community to agree on, then those are interesting for an Alberta, for any government to look at. So that's what happened. And as a result of that process and numerous other consultations and processes, the Alberta Climate Policy was born. The Alberta Climate Policy really did mark a huge shift in Canada, both from a public policy point of view and from the positions that the industry themselves took in supporting that policy. Jeff outlined the key elements: a price on carbon, a coal phase out, an investment in renewables, a methane plan, and a cap on emissions. And the cap on emissions is particularly interesting and was, we think, the most valuable piece in that. So what does the Alberta Climate Policy mean and what does it not mean? Under the existing, with no cap on emissions, with no cap of any kind, the industry was, of course, trying to build and are still trying to build both pipelines, Energy East and Kinder Morgan. What the cap on emissions means is with that cap, they actually do not need two pipelines. That they cannot produce the volume of bitumen that will require two pipelines. So we know, and they have told us, they will only build one pipeline. Which pipeline will it be? My great fear is that it will be the Kinder Morgan pipeline, for a number of reasons. One is that the Energy East pipeline is significantly larger than the Kinder Morgan pipeline, and various people in the oil patch will admit that, in fact, they can't increase production to the level that would fill the Energy East pipeline and still stay under the Alberta cap. Are you with me? You see what I mean? Okay. So the Energy East pipeline is basically just too big and would be very debatable. The Kinder Morgan pipeline is significantly smaller, and it does fit nicely under the Alberta cap. And the provincial government, while they have said they are opposed, are softening their opposition quickly. And we have many signs from Ottawa that they will, in fact, move to approve the Kinder Morgan pipeline when it goes to cabinet in December. So this is a big outstanding issue we have to deal with here in the province. But back to Alberta, what else does falls out from that Alberta policy? The price, in the end, I do believe that Jeff is right and that these high-cost, high-carbon fuels will be the first ones to go. And if the market continues the way it is, that will be what caps production. If there is some kind of major social unrest in one of the OPEC countries, you could see oil prices rise again. It's unlikely at this time, but we don't know what will happen, right? So if there was, then what we do have is a cap on emissions that's a legislated cap. It's not a production cap, it's a cap on emissions, but it is de facto a production cap. And so while we previously had 6 million barrels per day permitted to be extracted from the tar sands, the cap works out to about 3 million. So that's about half. They're not close to that yet, and I agree with Jeff that if they if the market conditions remain the same, they won't get close to it. But very interestingly, what you see is you now see the companies in Alberta all vying with each other for room under that cap. They all have various licenses, and the Alberta government has yet to determine a way to say which projects could go ahead and which ones actually can't go ahead. So one of the most interesting things about Alberta was that it laid the groundwork for Canada to go to Paris and take the progressive positions that we did. So the Alberta Climate Policy was announced last few weeks of November. Of course, Paris was the first few weeks of December. It was very interesting working with the federal government and the BC and Alberta governments. They were so determined to go to Canada and be a good player and tell a new story about Canada, because as you know, we were sick of getting that Fossil of the Day award. So I went to Paris. It was my very first COP. Who here has been to a COP? Yeah, it's like a crazy world within worlds, isn't it? It's just, so you are tens of thousands of you in a series of airplane hangars in a suburb of Paris from all over the world debating these issues from sunrise into the wee hours of the morning. I remember I was standing in line for a cappuccino, and behind me, in front of me, were two indigenous leaders from the Amazon, one of them wearing a big feather headdress. I had to kind of not get any feathers in my eye. And behind me are two men from Bhutan wearing their traditional robe. And I look over and I see a protest going on in the hallway, and it's 20 young people from island states, and they are all standing there in silence with a sign that says, 1.5 and I might still be alive. So I mean, it really is the whole world gathered here to have this conversation. And the 1.5, Canada wasn't expecting the 1.5. We were on our feet, as were many of the countries, dealing with the emergence of 1.5. And it was this bizarre feeling after 10 years of living under the Harper government to be proud that Canada got onto the right side and fought for 1.5. McKenna was really remarkable. She really did an amazing job. And the other piece that Canada promoted was something called, that people don't talk about, called the Paris Ambition Mechanism. And that's important because people point out the shortcomings of the Paris Treaty, and of course there are many. And of course, as your paper says, Jeff, the current commitments add up to more like 2.7 to 3.5 degrees. But there's something in there that Canada was a big advocate for called the Paris Ambition Mechanism, which means that the countries have to revisit and resubmit their targets. So that is that's the hope in there, that we still actually can get everything that we need at Paris. So we went to Paris and we did the right thing, but now we said the right thing, but saying it and doing it are two different things. So now we're back home, and 1.5 is right and a fairly radical thing, actually. 2 degrees, the 2 degrees was came up, the 2 degrees was invented, developed before we really had great modeling. 2 degrees essentially gives us a 50-50% of avoiding climate catastrophe. Well, 50, I'm looking for better odds than 50-50 myself. We got 1.5, and I think it's really important that we hang on to 1.5. You'll now hear politicians and government, you'll hear everyone now saying 2 degrees, sort of, 1.5, but I think it's really important that we hang on to 1.5. I think of those young people from the island states, they're very clear. 1.5, and they might still be alive. So we've got to hang on to 1.5. A couple of other just current issues and current dilemmas, how these issues that we're talking about tonight manifest. When Trudeau was here two weeks ago, he was there. He is using a similar line to a number of people in industry that we need these pipelines to fund the clean energy revolution. You're like, what? I mean, just think back to coal. So, I mean, now we agree we're phasing out coal. That would be like saying we need more coal to phase out coal. No, we don't. That's a dangerous narrative that is out there now that we also have to combat. Another one is around this question of oil to tidewater. You'll hear it. It's like a mantra. We must get oil to tidewater. We must get oil to tidewater. The idea is because we can get the Brent price of 37 that Jeff spoke about, as opposed to the WCS at 15 or 16. In fact, there are a number of economists coming out now and saying that is no longer true for a series of reasons, mostly related to the lifting of the US export ban, that we do not get a price premium for oil to tidewater. So I believe that it is not actually an economic argument. There's lots of economists coming on side. Michael Moore, not the Michael Moore from Flint, Michigan, but the Michael Moore who is the economist at University of Alberta, has just released a big paper on this issue. So I think it's a really interesting and important issue. I think oil to tidewater isn't an economic issue, it's an electoral issue. Both the federal government and the Alberta government think that getting a pipeline built, as opposed to the last guys who couldn't get one built, was really important to their electoral strategy. And I think we have to hold them to it and say, not so. Lastly, and in summary, what I might say is, what we really need to be doing now is having a conversation as a country about managed decline. This industry is in decline, and in more rapid decline than probably any of us, than many people certainly can imagine, and certainly than they want to imagine. And so what does it look like to really take responsibility as a developed country with all the privileges that we have that has this oil basin to really say, what does it look like to manage and plan decline in a rapid but reasonable way so that we can take care of the people in Alberta and take care of the people across Canada, but also take care of the young people standing with their signs, 1.5 and I may still be alive.
Thank you very much. We'll now move to the more conversational element of this. I'm actually going to take a little prerogative as being the moderator and ask a question only to ask for a quick answer, although it would certainly, one could answer it for longer, but you just give people a chance to think of either questions or comments. I'll take comments as well as questions, but please, we'll keep them short. But I'll direct this one directly to Jeff, because Dermot, in effect, you've already answered it for the funds that you manage. But as you know very well, we're sitting in a university context. The divestment issue is one that comes up in universities across Canada internationally. Given the economic scenario you painted, and just even just parking the emissions and political issues that you talked about and our other two panelists, why would anybody who's trying to rationally manage an asset for the long term want to stay invested in Canadian oil sands? Wouldn't you be trying to get out of that particular companies who have a heavy stake or totally invested in that as rapidly as you can in order to protect the value of your investment?
Well, I'm happy to say that one of my alma maters, University of Toronto, has recently voted to divest of oil sands. But you know, you talk about the long run. You know, what about the short run? You know, when Stanford University, to much public acclaim, said they were divesting from coal stocks, too bad that happened after Peabody Energy, Arch Coal, and Alpha Resources lost 90% of its market cap. You know, investing from the oil sands, yeah, I mean, they're going bankrupt. But, you know, probably 70% of the share losses are already in the rearview mirror. So, you know, the notion somehow is that these are stranded assets in the distant future. Guess what? Check out their share prices. They're stranded assets right now. So by the time, you know, U of T, UBC, McGill, Stanford University divests from it, gee, couldn't have we done this ex ante as opposed to ex post, would be my response as someone from the investment banking industry.
Great. Okay, well, that's exactly the kind of spirit we wanted. And I'm just going to remain seated. Well, I hope I can see people right to the back. We've got a great crowd. Please just raise your hands, and Angela's got a microphone. At the lady at two-thirds of the way at the back, on my left-hand side. Yeah, Maddie, yeah. And if you just introduce yourself very briefly, if you please.
Hi, I'm Melody. My question is, the narrative around this has always been, let's limit the increase through, you know, lower emissions, clean tech, carbon caps and trading. But what about the narrative of trying to, you know, decrease and exploring technology or industries around removing carbon dioxide from the atmosphere? Where is that in terms of the technology, the industry, and within the context of Canada?
Karen, do you want to take a stab at that?
I think it's not an or, but an and. I think that we need to limit emissions and do everything we can on the reduction side, but I also do think that we have to look at the technology side, because this is a sharp U-turn. You know, 1.5 degrees from where we are now, it is a sharp, sharp U-turn, and we need to do everything we can. There is a plant in Squamish that now is in the test phases and is actually has done it successfully around pulling CO2 out of the air, reformulating it, and being able to offer it as a fuel. Now it works out, the market isn't there for it yet, it's still too expensive, but there are promising technologies like that everywhere. So I think
I wonder what my friends would say about investment in those sectors. But for me, it would be, it's an and, not an or. We have to do both.
Want to add?
Yeah, just going to add, it's right now it's projected to be a very expensive technology. There's a plant in Saskatchewan, a coal-fired power plant, that does actually have carbon capture, but the cost to the Saskatchewan ratepayers who actually have to pay the electricity bill for that is phenomenal. And so that's when you get into, if the price of the control technology is so high, then why not explore all the alternatives? Because ultimately, carbon is going to come out of the atmosphere through trees. It's going to come out through the ocean. I mean, that's the natural processes for taking carbon dioxide out. That's going to happen. I don't know if on a magnitude of what's necessary, whether we have either the energy, the technology, or the capital to actually make a dent in what's in there right now. It's really, let's start working on improving our efficiencies, making sure we're not wasting as much energy as we do. The car, 80% of the energy in the car is used to move the car, not the person. So, we waste a tremendous amount of energy.
To capture even 10% of all the coal-fired emissions in the world would be equivalent to pumping under the ground as much volume as we pump oil out of the ground. So that just gives you some size of the enormity that we're talking about. As you point out, there are natural systems that do this for us. I think what we got to concentrate is on reducing combustion. And whether we reduce combustion through carbon taxes, whether we reduce combustion through supporting green energy, or the most effective way that we know of reducing combustion, which no one wants to advocate, is stop growing, because without fail, and I don't care what jurisdiction you're talking about, when you have a recession, emissions fall, whether they're mandated or not. I wrote a book about that, The End of Growth. The only person who thought that was bullish was your buddy, David Suzuki. Most people don't find that a palatable option, but up until now, that's our one sure-fired way. I'm not saying that there isn't some role for carbon capture and sequestration. I think one person mentioned we need $100 a ton. There's just the enormity of what we would have to sequester. But I think our focus has to be on reducing combustion of fossil fuels.
Great. And I'll just add a quick comment, which is Tim Flannery, the Australian climate scientist who was here in Vancouver a few months ago, his current book is largely about new technologies that are being developed that'll accelerate natural processes for extraction of carbon. So if you want to learn more, take a look at the things that he's tracking. So we've got a number of hands up, which is great. I'll just say the order. At the back of the room, the gentleman with his hand up right now, and then I think Lynn, who's in a black top, about halfway up front, and then woman behind her raising her hand. So that's the order we'll go in.
Hello, my name is Daniel. So I was curious about the notion of the trajectory of the investments, which the gentleman from Vancity spoke about. And I always wonder when I think about this topic is why aren't the huge companies, the big oil, we'll just call it, with so much capital investment potential and money at their disposal, why aren't they becoming part of the renewable energy movement? I mean, they already have the resources to do so. They're energy companies. Why do you think that they restrict the definition of their energy to just fossil fuel energy as opposed to wind or solar or any of those particular projects? And if you know of examples of companies, oil or energy companies that are doing this diversification of the kind of energy they produce, that would be appreciated. Thank you.
We might actually take those three questions and then let each of you respond. So, go. So that one is, why aren't big companies diversifying into renewables or doing more so?
So mine was actually related to the carbon capture. I panic a little bit when I hear it raised as a viable alternative, but I think that got picked up by some of the comments there, that the natural systems are the best that we have, and even they are not even able to begin to catch up. And the fact that we're relying heavily on technology that doesn't really even exist. I just wanted to add to what you already have said, that it's my understanding that the models for us to get to 1.5 or even to 2 include a lot of assumptions about carbon capture technology that doesn't exist today, that those will come on board. And then in fact, even with carbon capture technologies that are in our fantasies, we still can't go directly to 1.5, that we're gonna have to go over a hump and hopefully pull back down. And that even if we accomplish those things, sea level rise is a much slower, full of momentum change that we are not going to be able to pull back on. So I think all of those things, just to answer the earlier question or to add to the answer to the earlier question, address why we have to focus so heavily on emissions. Just wanted to add
Great.
That.
Thank you for that comment. And then third,
my experience in the environmental activism I've been involved in for over 30 years is it's really when the pocket gets pinched that you'll see change, whether it's recycling or pesticides, outdoor burning, like ultimately there's penalties, etc. So I'm curious as to whether a policy is being contemplated to address the ultimate investor, the ultimate customer, through the banking system and make a requirement through the banks that they divest their clients' portfolios together in conversation, be given a list of what they might suggest is a good alternative, and that their clients have to divest with their banker as kind of the educator and facilitator for that, but it's really the bank that is being required through policy to divest their clients' portfolios to some percentage.
Great. So I'll invite Jeff and Dermot maybe to respond to those two questions, and then Karen, if you want to add.
Okay, the banks.
Why don't they do more?
I worked in an investment bank for 20 years. It's not what they do with the deposit, it's not how depositors invest, it's do banks provide capital to the oil industry? And let me tell you the way it works. When you're a lead underwriter of a oil sands stock, if that company wants a loan, you don't tell them to see Royal Bank down the street, okay? So the loan book and the investment banking business are integrally related. Right now, one of the concerns of the Canadian banks is their exposure to the oil sands on the loan book side. And of course, that raises questions of potential loan loss write-downs, which is something that investors in banks are keenly aware of. About a month ago, 5 weeks ago, the five CEOs of the major Canadian banks had a joint conference telling the world that they don't have exposure to the oil industry. My 20 years in the investment banking industry suggests to me that when people go to great lengths to tell the public that they don't have exposure to the oil sands industry, precisely the opposite is true. Now, do we need moral sanctions to lobby the banks not to lend to the oil sands? I'd say in today's environment, that'd be superfluous. You know, you talk about pipelines, we only need one, two pipelines. Which banks do you think want to step up and finance and underwrite those pipelines in today's market? And what do you think the impact would be on their share values if they said, you know what, we want to significantly increase our exposure to the highest cost source of oil in the world when Brent is $37 a barrel? So the banks will look after their own interests. I think that right now, access to capital markets is very problematic for this sector, both in the debt markets, both in the equity markets, both in terms of bank loans. And the question now is, how long can these guys hang on? Because you just can't bleed red ink indefinitely. Now, you can hang on if you think this is 2 years and Brent's going back up to $110. Okay, you can do that. But the clock is ticking, and believe me, the banks will cut off credit exposure, not because of their environmental concerns per se, but because the loan book to that sector is now becoming a liability to those financial institutions. And anybody here, well, probably here is not the right sample size, but anybody who has invested, you know, in a Suncor, an Imperial Oil, or even some of the majors like Exxon, Suncor, and Total know exactly what I'm talking about.
Dermot, could you pick up maybe the first question, if I may? Because you've already explained Vancity's approach,
yeah.
But why don't companies invest in the oil sands diversify more into renewables? I think it was you who commented that their main ambition is to keep getting bigger in this sector that is constrained.
Exactly, and probably a few years ago, most people remember when BP was calling themselves Beyond Petroleum, right?
Yeah, right? Remember that?
And they had invested about $900 million in various renewable initiatives and ventures, but they didn't really pan out. Suncor has also been, they talk a lot about their investment in renewable energy, and they have invested in some wind energy, but it's not the heart of their business. I've sat down with the CEOs of some of these companies, and they are what you call oil men. It's what they're into. They understand the oil sands. They know if they put this much money into this much plant, they'll get this much out. And so it's really a question of having a new generation who understands energy, who understands why renewable energy is much more important. Another factor is, I just saw this article in the Wall Street Journal a couple of days ago about CEO compensation. And so a lot of the oil and gas companies reward their CEOs for adding more reserves and for producing more oil. And so that's what they're getting their bonus for. And if you're getting your bonus to produce more oil, to discover more oil, even when you're losing money on it, that tends to motivate them to keep doing what is in fact the wrong thing.
Great. Give an opportunity. We're coming close to time, so I'll just take three more hands up and quickly the order I saw them, which is a lot of hands. So we'll start with the gentleman, Maddie, a little further, closer to me with glasses. Hand up. Yep. You go first. And if you can make your question or comments quick so we can take another round.
This question's more for Jeff. First of all, thanks, everyone. This is really, really interesting. I'm just actually wondering about global reserves in general. Can you comment on whether or not the global availability of extractable oil is going to be an issue in markets in the future, given the time frame that you were talking about in your presentation?
Great. And then gentleman along the corridor there, his arm up, yes, next.
Is it mic on? Yeah. I'm actually an old client of Jeff's when Jeff used to do and be work in the capital markets at Wood Gundy. My question to Jeff is, it's going to probably parallel two things. One is your capital markets debt background and the current talk on carbon talks. Do you think that Alan Greenspan, through the quantitative, we had quantitative easing, we walk it back, we had very low interest rates for a long time, which was historical. Do you think that had a lot to do with the production levels that we were achieving and some of the consumption levels as well?
And then lastly, somebody at the very back of the room. Yep, at the very back, thank you. Yes, sir.
Thanks, my name is Eugene, I work with West Coast Environmental Law. I just wanted the rest of the panel to comment on the point that Karen raised around the price differential narrowing after the US lifted its export ban, and basically whatever the price of oil is changing the business case for these pipelines. And in addition, what the impact of a potential future cost on carbon for shipping in tankers, which is exempt from the Paris Agreement, what that might look like and how that might change those economics as well. Thanks.
Okay, well, let the three of you.
The first question, oil reserves. Oil reserves are not some geological concept. They're an economic concept. In other words, how much oil we have depends on the price of oil. And take the Canadian oil sands, which would be a perfect example of this. This is not a new discovery. It was never considered a reserve. It was never considered a reserve because when oil was $20 a barrel, it wasn't economically viable to to access this reserve. Then, you know, when oil prices got to $100 a barrel, all of a sudden the International Energy Agency said, this is the third largest oil reserve in the world. You know, if oil goes to $200 a barrel, then other kinds of, like Arctic oil, all of a sudden becomes a reserve. So the notion of a reserve is not an absolute geological context. It's as much an economic context as it is geological. The higher oil prices are, the more oil we have to access because unconventional sources are accessible. And most of the supply has come from unconventional, whether it's shale, whether it's oil sands, whether it's deep water, and that's all a function of rising oil prices. Low oil prices shut oil in the ground because while the oil exists physically, it's not economically viable to extract it. The second question, quantitative easing, to go back to my old world, I think what the question is the extraordinary efforts to stimulate the economy, Alan Greenspan quantitative easing today, negative interest rates in Europe and Japan. How have that affected oil? Well, all of a sudden, these policies were designed to support economic growth. And of course, as I mentioned in my earlier comment, it's economic growth that really drives oil. I mean, oil remains the single largest source of fuel in the world economy. So, you know, any policies that stimulate growth, whether they're fiscal or monetary, are obviously going to heighten the consumption of fossil fuels because fossil fuels account for 80% of the energy that drives global GDP.
Great. Karen, do you want to touch the last question on possible constraints on shipping fuels or?
Well, specifically on this question of oil to tidewater, we started talking about it a little bit before the panel, Jeff. But that essentially, they're arguing that they can get $37 a barrel. The truth is that that tar sands oil is heavy oil that has to be refined only in a certain kind of refinery. The truth is that Asia doesn't have the scale of refineries for processing tar sands oil that you do have in the Midwest and the Gulf Coast. Mm. So it is a fallacy that it has now become a fallacy that we will magically start getting $37 a barrel and we'll be opened up to this huge Asian market. And yet they are using that argument to say that's why we have to build a pipeline to the coast. And I think we should challenge them heavily on that. As I said, I do think it's an electoral strategy, not an economic one. And that they're using it to try and build this capacity from the industry's point of view, you know, because I think some part of them is just in some denial and believes the price will go up. There's definitely a denial coping strategy going on. And for the governments, they believe that this is sort of in their electoral interests.
At $37 a barrel, you're not going to see anybody investing in new oil sands production. Because all of the new oil sand projects, you know, Jocelyn Mine, Pierre River, the Carmen Steam projects, all that have been canceled, have costs well above what today's Brent is. Now, I'll grant you that it's better to get 38 than get 17, but when your average cost of production is 45 to 60, you're still going out of business. You just take a little longer, that's all.
Well, thank you very much. I'd love to continue this as a public session, but we were to go to 90 minutes. The good news is that we actually now have an informal session with drinks in the back of the room. So for the many of you who had your hands up, please, all our speakers will be with us for a while. Please come and ask questions, and let's carry on the conversation informally. I'd like to say that, I mean, this has only stimulated further interest. For me, it's left a lot of questions in my mind, which we didn't have a chance to get to, about the timeframes around which decisions are made by companies, the lag which national governments address those in terms of the lag in terms of public perceptions and business perceptions in terms of what's really going to happen, how slow moving this industry was to start up, and the huge sunk costs, the massive sunk costs of investment, how slow it's going to be to turn around. It comes across, particularly in your analysis and amplified by both what Dermot and what Karen has said,
is actually much more vulnerable than I think a great majority of Canadians would appreciate. Vulnerable to price change, vulnerable to competition, vulnerable to technology, and now vulnerable to an international climate regime, which we hope is coming soon to a country near all of us. So with that, I'd really like to thank the organizers of tonight's event. First and foremost to Jeff, who's given us this great paper in the CG, who's brought him here to Vancouver, to the David Suzuki Foundation, who's our partner, to our sponsors in Carbon Talks, PIX, and the North Growth Foundation. And then thanks to all of you. We'll be doing another public carbon talk next week at lunchtime on Wednesday on the issue energy democracy and energy equity, which is another issue that I think is going to have increasing exposure in the future in Canada. And thank you all for coming. Please stay and enjoy the evening.